welcome again to this particular session. And flashing on your screens, you can see higher purchase installment sale transactions. So this is the chapter which we are going to start today. Needless to add that it happens to be pretty strong, formidable chapter. And from the examination point of view, quite obviously, you are quite keen to know the probability factor of question coming from this particular chapter is quite high. So that should work as a motivational factor that why you need to actually pay a bit of extra attention to what we call gain higher command over this particular chapter. We come straight to the point, to the business end now. What exactly we mean by higher purchase transactions, correct? As we normally call this chapter, so let me first of all create a space for me so that I can write a wee bit. So nowadays we are using this electronic gadgetry, honestly speaking, which I personally don't prefer, correct, to be very honest with you. But we have to move along with the time, and student fraternity nowadays are quite fond of such digital teachings. I'm fond of whiteboard teachings. So let's start with higher purchase system. What exactly the higher purchase is? Now, under the agreement of higher purchase system, because you are quite well aware of this particular term, it, no doubt about it. Under the, suppose I'm going to ask you, what is higher purchase system? You will be able to tell me, I know. So what is higher purchase system? So under the contract of higher purchase, we will see that owner of the asset actually allows the purchaser or the buyer of the asset to take the possession of the goods or the possession of the asset by paying a little bit of amount at the time of what we call purchase itself, and he will be asked to pay the balance amount in some what we call agreed or specified installment. Are you getting my point or not? Suppose today I'm interested in buying an LED, correct? Now, I can take the LED by simply paying a very small amount, let us say 20,000 rupees at the time of purchase itself, and the seller will ask me to pay the balance amount in some what we call installment. So this is known as what we call higher purchase system. Quite obviously, the seller will be known as the owner of the asset, generally is known as seller of the asset, while the purchaser is known as what we call higher vendor. So before we move into the practical area of this particular chapter, let's write with it, and then I'm going to actually explain the each and every point in detail to you. So pull out your pen, pencil and everything and start writing along with me, correct? So higher purchase system. Under this particular point, first of all, you need to understand that in India, all the higher purchase transactions are governed by Higher Purchase Act of 1972, because nowadays you are being also asked objective type question. So it is very important for you to actually keep a little bit of eye on the theory, correct? So let's write immediately. Higher Purchase Act, in short form, I have written HPA, correct? Higher Purchase Act of 1972 deals with higher purchase transaction. HP means higher purchase transactions. Is it clear to you? This is the first point which you need to know. Now, I just told you a moment ago what we mean by a higher purchase agreement or higher purchase transaction. So, under the agreement of higher purchase, under the agreement or contract of higher purchase transaction, comma, owner of the asset allows the buyer. As I told you a moment ago, that under this particular agreement, the owner of the asset will allow the buyer to take the possession of the asset, allows the buyer to take position, to take possession of the asset against, against some initial payment. Initial payment means payment at the time of purchase, against some initial payment. INITIAL, initial payment. Initial payment. The balance amount shall be paid in periodic installments. In periodic installments. Of course, the balance amount will be paid by the buyer, correct, in some periodic installment. The installment could be what we call monthly, could be yearly, could be quarterly, it could be anything, but it will be mutually agreed. So this is what we mean by hire purchase transaction. Now, before we move further, let us also have a bit of knowledge that, so that we should not commit any mistake later on. The owner of the asset, owner of the asset is known as hire vendor. Generally in accounts, word vendor is used to denote the seller because owner of the asset is selling the asset. So owner of the asset is known as hire vendor. He is known as hire vendor or hire seller. Hire vendor or seller. Correct? The owner of the asset is known as hire vendor or seller. While the buyer is known as what? If owner is known as hire vendor, what will you call the buyer? Sir, hire purchaser. Very good. The buyer is known as hire purchaser. He is known as hire purchaser or simply hire purchaser or simply hirer. Hirer. H-I-R-E-R, because when I'm paying you some amount at the initial stages and I'm taking your asset, correct? That means till I'm going to make the final payment, till that particular date, actually it means actually I'm simply hiring the asset from you, correct? That is why the purchaser is known as hirer. Is it clear to you or not? Yes, sir. Then further, what you should be aware of regarding this particular fact. I told you, when buyer will take the asset, he will have to actually pay some initial amount. That initial amount is known as I told you earlier, initial amount is known as what? Initial amount is known as down payment, known as down payment. There are so many names. Down payment, it is known as down payment also. It is known as signing amount also. It is known as signing amount also. Signing amount. Correct? So these are the things which you should be aware of regarding what we call at least hire purchase system. Now, second point is that the Hire Purchase Act 1972 states very clearly that whenever seller will sell the goods on hire purchase system to the purchaser, correct? Something should be clearly mentioned. Now, what are those things? Let's have a look. As per Hire Purchase Agreement, As per Hire Purchase Act of 1972, as per Hire Purchase Act of 1972, Section 4, if you want to write, actually there is no need to learn section in accounts. Section 4, following amount or following information, following must be clearly mentioned. Following must be mentioned in HP agreement, hire purchase agreement. It is important for the seller that he should mention clearly what? A, hire purchase price. Now, what is hire purchase price? I will let you know in a short while. Don't worry about hire purchase price. We will see later on, hire purchase price is nothing but down payment plus all the installment which you are going to pay. It is as simple as that. Then it is the duty of the seller also to mention in the agreement the cash price. Now, what is the cash price? That I will let you know. Just wait for a while. Correct? And then, besides that, he should also mention very clearly the date on which the hire purchase will commence. Date on which hire purchase agreement would commence. That is very important, at least for accounting. The date on which hire purchase agreement would commence. Then, besides these things, he should also mention the number of installment, because the balance amount, as I told you, will have to be paid by the purchaser in some installment. So a hire purchase agreement must contain the total number of installment which the buyer is supposed to pay. Number of installments. Not only number of installment, but also what we call amount of each installment. Further, it should be clearly mentioned on what date the installment should be paid. Date of payment of installment. It should be clearly mentioned also. The hire purchase agreement clearly states that it is bounded duty that agreement should contain all this information, and last information is amount of down payment. Nowadays, you need to pay a bit of attention towards theory also, because lots of MCQs are being asked. So that is very important for you to pay attention. Correct the theory which I generally write before starting the what we call practicals. Even if you will do this much of theory, you can easily handle any question of which will be asked of. Correct? Then we move over to another important point. The another important point is that hire purchase agreement also clearly states that if any default is committed by the hire purchaser, for example, I am the seller, I have asked the what we call hire purchaser to pay down payment today, and at the end of the first year you will pay me this much amount, at the end of the second year you will pay me this much of amount, and at the end of the third year you will pay me this much of the amount. That means the purchaser is supposed to pay 3 installments. Correct? Now let us say he pays the first installment, he pays the second installment, but he fails to pay the third installment. When he fails to pay the third installment, in accounting terminology, we will say that default has been committed. It means if the purchaser has committed any default, so in that particular case, the Hire Purchase Act specifies that seller has the right to take back the possession of the goods sold. Correct? So next point is related to this only. In case of default, In case of default, in case of default, comma, the vendor, hire vendor, vendor means the seller. I will write seller. The seller has the right to repossess means to reacquire, to repossess the goods sold. Repossess the goods sold. Is it clear to you? Now, the next point I just want to specify is that hire purchase system, we will see later on, we will talk about hire purchase installment system also, but we will talk about that later on. But let me actually finish a little bit of what we call a portion of this one. Hire purchase system differs from installment system. Now there is installment system also, and most of us actually are under impression that hire purchase system and installment system are one and same thing. However, there is a slight difference. Hire purchase system differs from installment system in what sense? That is, installment system, we will see that under the installment system basically is considered as a contract of sale. Installment system is contract of sale. What we mean by contract of sale, I will explain you also. Contract of sale. Under installment system, purchaser gets ownership immediately at the time of possession of goods. So this is the big difference between hire purchase system and installment system. Even under the installment system also, the seller will ask the purchaser to pay initially some amount and take the possession of the goods. But the point you need to note is that under the hire purchase system, if I will pay initial deposit, I will get the possession of the goods, but I will not acquire the ownership of the goods. Till I am not going to make the final payment, I cannot be called as the real owner of the goods. Is it clear to you or not? Under hire purchase system, the purchaser will get the ownership only on payment of the final installment. Whereas under hire purchase system, just by paying the initial deposit, you can take the possession. And not only the possession, but you will also become the owner of the goods. This is the big difference between the installment system and hire purchase system. Further, we will see that in case of hire purchase system, we already saw that in case the default is committed by the purchaser, so seller has the right in that particular case to reacquire the goods, isn't it or not? Whereas under installment system, we will see that even though if the default is committed by the purchaser, the seller has no right to take back the goods. Of course, he can file what we call or case against the same. Seller has no right to repossess the goods sold. However, as I told you, he can take some legal step. He can sue the purchaser for recovery of balance amount. This is the big difference between installment system and hire purchase system. Balance amount. Further, under installment system, once I have become the owner of the goods, because under installment system I am talking about, under installment system I will pay the initial deposit, take the possession, and now I am the owner of the goods, correct? So because now I am the owner of the goods, so I have the right to actually even sell the goods to somebody else, which is not the case in case of hire purchase system. I have already told you, under hire purchase system, the purchaser cannot become the owner of the goods until he would pay the last installment, correct? So under installment system, you should also write that purchaser has the right to sell or pledge or rent the asset. So this sort of right exists with the purchaser under installment system, because under installment system he will immediately become the owner of the goods the moment he is going to actually pay the initial deposit. Is it clear to you or not? Under hire purchase system, I have already told you, the purchaser will not become the owner of the goods unless he would pay the final installment. I will write it also for you. Under hire purchase system, HPS, comma, hire purchaser, shall not acquire till he would pay the last installment. So only after paying the last installment he can get the ownership of the goods. Now very important, correct? See, as a professional student, you need to pay attention to such things. This should not be your motive only to what we call simply learn the art of solving the question. It will not hold you in a very good state later on, correct? So try to understand some important point. In accounts, general rule is that I cannot show any asset in my financial, especially in my balance sheet, because assets are represented in balance sheet. I cannot show any asset in my balance sheet unless and until I am the real owner of that particular good. Are you getting my point or not? Unless and until I am not the real owner of that particular good. Now suppose if I ask you a particular question, let us say Mr. A acquires an asset on hire purchase system. Mr. A acquires an asset on hire purchase system. And let us say he has paid only down payment so far, and he is supposed to pay three more installments. After paying the down payment or the initial amount or the signing amount, he is supposed to pay three more installments. But he will get the possession of the goods, no doubt about that, as I have already told you now, that after having paid the down payment and the hire purchase system, we will get the possession of the goods. Now my question to you is that, suppose Mr. A has acquired a machinery on hire purchase system, correct? So can Mr. A show this machinery in its balance sheet? Can Mr. A now show this machinery in the balance sheet? It is a very tricky question. I told you, you cannot show any item as an asset in your balance sheet logically unless and until you are the owner of that particular asset. Logically, I should not show this asset machinery towards asset side when I will prepare my financials. I'm talking from the perspective of Mr. A, because Mr. A has acquired the machinery. But, now pay attention here. Logically or surfacially, we are not the owner, no doubt about that, because we cannot become the owner of this particular asset unless and until we would pay all the installments, correct? So unless and until I would pay the third installment, I cannot become the real owner of this particular goods. I am Mr. A now. But even though I have purchased the asset on down payment, I will still show this item towards the asset side. Now you may wonder, sir, you are contradicting your own statement. Just a moment ago, I told you, unless and until I am the real owner of the goods, I cannot show any item towards the asset side. For a while, it seems actually we are not the real owner, correct? For a while, it seems we are not the legal owner, because surfacially, when we look into the matter, the ownership is still not delivered to us. We have just paid the down payment. But if we will look deeply into it, correct? If we will look deeply into it, in real terms, who is using the asset? Mr. A is using the asset. Because in reality, the owner is actually Mr. A, because he is using the asset, even though in legal terms, he may not be the owner, but in real terms, he is the owner. And you have heard a lot in accounts about substance over form. You have heard about it, substance over form. Isn't it or not? What is substance over form? Substance over form. Form means something which is viewed from surfacially. As I told you, surfacially means from the exterior angle, it seems that we are not the real owner. But substance means if we will look deeply into it, we'll find that because we are using the asset, because we are using this asset in the production of what we call goods and services, quite obviously, that means in substance, we are the real owner. And that is why, even though Mr. A, or should I say hire purchaser, is not the owner of the asset, still he is going to show the asset towards the what we call asset side. So sometime a question may be asked, correct, in this manner also. So you should be in a position to know all these things. Is it clear to you? Yes, sir. Now absolutely things are clear. Now obviously the next thing is that I need to tell you what we mean by hire purchase price, cash price, and what is the theme of this particular chapter, what we are supposed to do under this particular chapter. Isn't it or not? Is it clear? Yes, sir. Absolutely. So in order to make you understand, correct, let us have a look over here. And then I will be able to explain all the things which I want. Even if you are not having the notes at this moment, if you are having the notes, it's fine. Even if you are not having, you need not require to actually worry a single bit about that. As you know, we have divided every chapter into some sections. And even in this particular section in branch accounts, we did almost 100 questions. And similarly, as far as hire purchase is concerned, correct, this is quite a strong chapter. Very strong chapter, but at the same time, very long also. Correct? So, This is your section 1, calculation of interest. First of all, we are going to learn the calculation of interest. Why we will have to learn the calculation of interest? As I told you, what is the theme of this particular chapter? Because we haven't yet talked about that particular thing. So we will try to understand with the help of this particular question. First, go through this particular question. In this particular question, it is written, Welkin's Transport Company purchases a motor car from Bombay Motors Limited. Now, my first question to you, who is hire purchaser and who is hire vendor? Could you tell me who is the hire purchaser? Bombay Motors Limited is the hire purchaser? No, sir. Welkin's Transport Company is the hire purchaser. Fine. So Welkin's Transport Company happens to be the hire purchaser. Fine. And who is hire vendor? Bombay Motors Limited is the hire vendor. Which asset Welkin's Transport Company has purchased, sir? Motor car. This is the asset which we have purchased. This way round, you will have to actually go through the question always. Is it clear to you or not? Now, further, we have been given that this item was purchased on hire purchase system. On hire purchase system. Correct? On hire purchase agreement on 1st of January 2020. So, agreement took place on 1st of January 2020. 10,000 cash was paid by Welkin's Transport Company and it was agreed to pay further 3 installment. That means Welkin's Transport Company has paid 10,000 on the date of agreement itself. So 10,000 will become your down payment. And further, Welkin's Transport Company also agreed to pay 3 more installments of 10,000 each on 31st of December each year. On 31st of December each year. Further, it is written that cash price of the car is 37,250. What we mean by cash price, I will let you know everything. Don't worry in detail. And Bombay Motor, which is the seller, Bombay Motor charges interest at 5% per annum. And there is another line given that purchaser writes off 10% per annum as depreciation or reducing balance system. So now we will try to analyze this particular question. Let's have a look. Over here, let me create a space for me as I told you earlier. Correct? So we finished here, right? So we'll pick up section. This is section one, no doubt about that. Section one of our book or our notes, whatever you may like to call it. Section one and question number 1 also, that is 1.1. 1.1 means section 1, question number 1. But before I let you know how to solve it, I would like to actually pay attention towards this. I am simply analyzing the question because in case if some of you are not having the notes, you can understand it better. The question which we just read, it states that there is a company by the name of WTC. WTC means Welkin's Transport Company. WTC. Correct? And there is another company by the name of Bombay Motors. So I am simply writing BM. And it was given in the question that on 1-1-2020, Welkin's Transport Company acquired a motor car on hire purchase system. So WTC in this particular case will be termed as hire purchaser. I am simply writing HP, hire purchaser. And Bombay Motors will be termed as hire vendor. Is it clear to you? Yes, sir, absolutely clear. As per the agreement which we just saw, WTC, who is the purchaser, will pay 10,000 because the agreement took place on 1-1-2020. So on this date, WTC Limited will pay 10,000 rupees as the down payment. WTC Limited will pay 10,000 rupees as down payment. This is down payment. And as per the agreement, WTC Limited will pay 3 more installments. The first installment will be paid on 31st of December 2020 because it is clearly given in the question that installment are supposed to be paid at the end of each year. So year will end on 31st of 12. The first year end will take place first year end. This is the beginning of the first year. First year end will take place on 31st of 12, 2020. Similarly, second year will end on 31st of 12, 2021. Correct? Second year. And finally, your third year will end on 31st of 12, 2022. Is it clear to you or not? As I told you, at the end of the first year, Wilkins Transport Company will pay 10,000, then again 10,000, then at the end of the third year, I will pay 10,000. Further in this particular question, if you have seen and gone through, then you must have noticed that in this particular question, it was also given to us that cash price was 37,250. And question also stated that Bombay Motors is charging 5% interest. Now we will analyze this entire question in a threadbare analysis to make you understand with the terminologies, to make you understand with the fact what is higher purchase price, what is cash price, and what we are supposed to do in this particular chapter. Because sometime I have seen, in fact, on many occasions I have seen, correct, that a student is able to solve the question, but they do not know actually what they are doing and why they are doing. So that is also very important. Let's have a look over here, and a little bit of patience I would like to have from you. If you really want to dig very deep in this particular chapter, initially, if you can show a little bit of patience, then I'm very sure then rest of the chapter will become almost as always, as I keep on saying, a stroll in the park, correct? So now we start solving the question. Whenever you solve the question, always try to note all these things. Ask yourself, what is the cash price in the question? What is the cash price in the question? So cash price was given to us as 37,250. In this question, cash price was 37,250. Now I tell you the meaning of cash price. What is cash price? Correct? Cash price basically means the price which the purchaser will have to pay in lump sum. Suppose if seller would have bought the asset by paying full amount at the time of purchase itself, then he would have had to pay 37,250. Are you getting my point or not? Who is the purchaser in this case? WTC Limited is the purchaser. And as per the what we call information given in the question, they have bought a motor car and initially they have paid 10,000 and they are supposed to pay three more installment of 10,000 each. That means in total, actually, they are going to pay 40,000. But if they had paid the full amount at the time of purchase itself, then they would have had paid 37,250 only. Is it clear to you or not? So cash price is the price which is paid in lump sum, that is full amount, at the time of purchase itself. But remember one thing, cash price is different from the cost price. Even in cash price, there is some profit margin. Suppose if I am going to buy this asset by paying the full amount, how much I had to pay in that particular case? 37,250. So that doesn't mean that seller is not going to actually charge any profit. Even in this price, some profit margin must be there. No doubt about that. Is it clear to you or not? Yes, sir. So cash price literally basically means cost price plus profit margin. Correct? Cost price plus profit margin. Is it clear to you? So we do not know the cost price of this particular asset because it is not given in the question. Only cash price is given in the question. But cash price means the amount which is paid in full at the time of purchase itself. So logically, the price of this particular asset, motor vehicle, is 37,250. Logically, its price is 37,250. Now, that's a different matter because you bought this asset on higher purchase system. That is why you are paying little bit extra amount. Correct? Now, after acquainting ourselves what we mean by what we call cash price, now let's move a little bit further. Now in the next point, what you have to do, in the next point you try to note what is the down payment. So down payment in this case is 10,000. That is fine. In accounts, and many among us do not know, and tomorrow, later on, after completing what we call your professional course, if you are going to actually face some interview, correct? They are going to ask sometime a question like this. Could you tell us what numbering you generally give to down payment? You may wonder, we never actually studied that. So down payment is also known as zero installment. Is it clear to you? This is the zero installment. Correct? Now, first installment is this one. Second installment is this one. Third installment is this one. This is your first installment. This is your second installment. This is your third installment. And down payment is technically known as zero installment. Correct? Anyway, so zero installment or down payment is 10,000. Now, at the end of the first year, you are going to pay your first installment, no doubt about that, 10,000. Then at the end of the second year, you are going to pay 10,000 more. Then at the end of the third year, you are going to pay another installment of 10,000. So in total, you are going to pay the full amount, that is 10, 10, 10, that is 40,000 in 3 years period of time. Is it clear? Now, this 40,000 is known as higher purchase price. This is known as higher purchase price. Is it clear to you or not? Why it is known as higher purchase price? Because in this particular case, you are not picking up the asset by paying the full amount. You are picking up the asset simply by paying some down payment, simply by down payment, and rest of the installment you will pay almost in 3 years period of time. So it is presumed as if for 3 years you have taken this asset on hire, that is on rent. Is it clear to you? That is why it is known as higher purchase price. Quite obviously, if the seller is going to give you 3 years time facility, correct? Obviously, he has every right to charge little bit extra than the what we call cash price. Because if you would have acquired the asset by paying the full amount, you had to pay 37,250. But now here I am taking 3 years time facility. So logically I will pay a little bit extra, that is 40,000. Now the second point is, so what is down payment? What is higher purchase price if somebody asks you? So simply put, higher purchase price means down payment plus installment. Is it clear to you? Down payment plus installment sums up what we call higher purchase price. Now, under the second step, under C, you take the difference of these two amounts due to some or other reason. Correct? If I will take the difference, 40,000 minus 37,250, I think it will be equal to 2,750. This difference is known as interest. This difference is known as interest. This difference is known as interest. As I told you just a moment ago, if at the time of purchase itself, I had paid the full amount, then how much I would have had paid? I would have had paid 37,250 only. But because I acquired the asset on hire purchase system, got 3 years time facility, quite obviously I will be charged more, and that is the reason I am paying 40,000. So how much extra I am paying? How much extra I am paying? I am paying 2,750. This extra amount is known as interest amount. Why this extra amount you are paying? Because you are taking a time facility of 3 years, and any charge against time facility in accounts is known as interest. That is why it is called as interest. Is it clear to you or not? Absolutely, sir. Now we are getting a little bit of idea. So nice of you. If that is the situation, now in this question, it was also given to you that purchaser is charging 5% interest also. How I am going to use it, I will let you know in a short while. Just pay attention. Correct? So what under accounts we have to do, still I haven't told you. So far, I have just explained what is higher purchase price, what is cash price, and what is interest. Interest, obviously, the difference between the higher purchase price and interest price. Is it clear to you? Now, you need to understand one important point here also. Just a moment ago, I told you what is higher purchase price. The higher purchase price basically means down payment plus installment amount. Plus installment. Total installment amount. For example, down payment is 10,000 and total installment amount is 10,000 into 3 because I am paying 3 installment. So that will be equal to 40,000. That is higher purchase price. Higher purchase price is also written as cash price plus interest, as we just saw. Because cash price is 37,250 and interest is actually how much? 2750. Now your cash price is 37,250, as we have noted down, 37,250, and interest happens to be 2750. So it will be equal to 40,000. Now you need to understand one important point. You need to understand, this is very, very important. From the perspective of the purchaser, why I'm stressing upon the purchaser, because most of the accounting we will have to do in the books of the purchaser, most of the accounting, correct? I'm not telling that accounting will not be done in the books of our vendor, the seller. It will also be done over there, but most major portion of the accounting we will have to do in the books of the purchaser. From the perspective of the purchaser, cash price is also known as cost price. Correct? From the perspective of the purchaser. Because you are the purchaser, whatever price you will pay to get the asset, that will become cost for you. Now, in that regard, you may say, sir, we are paying actually, in this case, 40,000. So 40,000 should be what we call cost price for us. Yes, you are right, absolutely. But the point, try to understand. What is the price of the goods which is kept in the showroom? The price of the goods in this case, which is kept in the showroom, is 37,250. This is the price. That's a different matter that you did not pay the full amount and you agree to take the possession of the goods by paying 10,000 and you also agree to pay 30,000 more. But that will not change the cash price of the what we call item. The cash price will remain 37,250. It means you agree to pay 37,250 plus 2750 extra because you are taking time facility. And both these combinedly will be termed as higher purchase. So from the perspective of the purchaser, remember one thing, cash price is also known as cost. Because if higher purchaser, as I told you, would have paid full amount at the time of purchase, he had to pay only 37,250. So his cost would have been 37,250. And now because he got the asset by taking some time facility, he is paying 2750. This is the interest. So from the perspective of the purchaser, please pay attention because I will use these terms so often later on. It is very important for you to actually gain complete command of this particular item. So cost plus interest, from the perspective of the purchaser will tell to him that I have acquired an asset costing 37,250. However, I am going to pay 40,000. Why? Because I will have to pay 2750 as interest. This is how the purchaser will analyze the thing. Is it clear to you or not? From the perspective of the purchaser will be of the opinion that cost price of this particular asset happens to be 37,250, but I am paying 2750 more because I am taking what we call time facility of 3 years. Obviously, whatever extra I am paying, that is because of time facility, that is because of interest. Is it clear to you or not? Yes, sir, absolutely clear. Now, if it is absolutely clear, I am trying to make you understand what is the theme of this particular chapter, because most of us actually neglect this important part. Even after what we call doing several questions, we do not know actually what we are doing and why we are doing. So try to understand this particular point. Now, actually this is the rough one, correct? I will rub it later on also. You need not require to write at this moment. Simply have a look over here. I got the asset for 40,000, no doubt about it. How much I paid? I paid 10,000 initially. Remember one thing, I am the purchaser. I have analyzed this entire scenario in this manner, that for me, that means for the purchaser, the cost price is 37,250, but we are paying 2750 extra amount because we are taking time facility. In total, we are supposed to pay 40,000, correct? That day on which I got the asset, I paid 10,000 rupees. Suppose you take a loan from a bank today, and immediately you pay 10,000, and let us say you have taken a loan of 40,000, and immediately you pay 10,000. So on 10,000, no interest will be charged because you took the loan today itself, and you are repaying what we call 10,000 at the same time. So that means whatever you paid, that did not contain any element of interest. Is it clear to you? Similarly, when I acquired this particular asset, and for me, the cost price is 37,250 and interest happens to be 2750, and I am paying 10,000 immediately. That means in this 10,000, this is known as zero installment, correct? That is down payment. That means in this payment, there is no interest. I am not paying anything for interest. So after having paid the down payment, now what is the situation? The situation is that I'm still supposed to pay 27,250 for the cost of the asset. Try to understand actually. And I'm still supposed to pay 2750. That means still I'm supposed to pay 30,000. Are you getting my point or not? Correct? No doubt I have to pay 30,000. Now I'm trying to tell you actually this 30,000 comprises of two things. Cost price, you are still supposed to pay 27,250 for the cost price, and you are still supposed to pay 2750 for the interest portion. Down payment has been paid at the beginning of the accounting year. Now we are going to reach the end of the accounting year. Now the first year will end on which date? That is 31st of 12, 2020. The first year will end on this particular date. Now, when I am going to pay 10,000 more, correct, on this date I am supposed to pay 10,000 more because this is my first installment at the end of the first year. I'm trying to make you understand what is the theme of this particular chapter. Please try to pay attention. And secondly, second installment I am going to pay on 31st of 12, 2021. That is again 10,000 rupees. And last installment I am going to pay on 31st of 12, 2022. And again 10,000. No doubt about that, because I'm supposed to pay 30,000, so I will have to pay 30,000. Now try to understand. Suppose if I pay on this particular date at the end of the first year, suppose I make the payment of 10,000, correct? The point is that I need to know how much I am paying for the cost price and how much I am paying for the interest, and that is the theme of this particular chapter. That means every installment which you are going to repay, you need to break it into portions which you are paying for cost and the portion which you are paying for interest. And why? Because out of 10,000, the portion which you are making payment against the cost is known as capital payment. And the portion which you are going to pay for interest is a revenue payment. Is it clear to you or not? What is the theme of this particular chapter? So on this basis, I will have to do the accounting. And every time I am going to repay the installment, I will have to find out what portion I am paying for what we call cost and what portion I am going to pay for interest. Actually, while doing the accounting, we will never write the word cost because that is not written in Hire Purchase Act. Just for the sake of understanding, I am trying to tell you that you in your mind, because while doing the accounting in the books of hire purchaser, you must keep in your mind that cash price is a sort of cost price for the purchaser, correct? So this is the theme of this particular chapter. I will have to find out what portion of the installment I am paying for cash price or cost price and what portion I am paying for interest, and why we have to break it off or split it off, because one portion is considered as capital payment and other portion is considered as revenue nature payment. The revenue nature payment, as you know, will be debited to the profit and loss account later on when we are going to prepare the financials. So this is the theme of this particular chapter. I told you this is the rough work. I will rub it out and now I will solve it further to make you understand better. Correct? Now there is no need, you have got the theme. So now we have acquainted ourselves, what is the cash price? Don't forget, cash price also contains some profit. What is cash price? What is hire purchase price? Correct? What is cash price? What is higher purchase price? And I have now explained the theme of what we call this particular chapter, that ultimately we will have to find out what portion we are paying for cash price and what portion we are paying for what we call interest. So in this question, basically we are supposed to learn the computation of interest payment. In fact, we are supposed to know that how much we are paying, how we are going to actually split the installment into portions as payment for what we call cash price and payment for interest. So that is known as calculation of interest. This topic is known as calculation of interest, but we are going to learn exactly what, exactly that which I just mentioned a moment ago. So now, in order to solve the question, this is the solution of this particular question. In order to solve this particular question, first of all, in one column, you write particulars. Particulars. And in the next column, you write cash price. I told you, while doing the accounting, we will always use the term cash price. But in your mind, you need to keep that from the perspective of the purchaser, cash price is nothing but cost price. Although we will have to write cash price, we cannot write cost price, correct? Interest. And then you write here cash price portion. It's a pretty long word, cash price portion. Cash price portion. Try to understand. Now, first of all, what you are supposed to do, simply under the column of the particulars, write the what we call your cash price. Sorry, under cash price column, you simply write cash price. Your cash price was 37,250. Correct? Your cash price was 37,250. Now, here you write date 1/1/2020 and then you write down payment. On this date, you made a payment of 10,000 rupees. You simply write it below the cash price. Correct? Because whatever payment you are going to make on the date of agreement, that means the day on which actually you acquired this asset, that means this amount we are paying against this price only. That means down payment will never ever contain any interest element. Is it clear to you or not? So in this case, I will write here cash price. I will subtract what we call 10,000. Then I will be left up with how much? I will be left up with 27,250. 27,250. Is it clear to you or not? Yes, sir. Absolutely clear. Now, down payment amount was 10,000. This 10,000 you subtracted from the cash price. So the position is that still we are on 1/1/2020. That means on this particular date, we have simply made a payment of 10,000. That is why we are saying that cash price or cost price from our perspective, that means from the perspective of the purchaser, is 27,250. Now we come to the end of the first year, that is 31st of 12 2020. At the end of the first year, obviously I will have to make the payment for first installment. Now think of what was your first installment. Sir, first installment is actually 10,000. Fine, your first installment is 10,000, correct? Now, because you have reached the end of the first year, that means 12 months period has gone by now, correct? 12 months period has gone by now. Is it clear to you or not? Presume for a while that you have taken a loan of 37,250 from a bank at 5%, let us say. And you repay 10,000 on the same day, so no interest will be charged here. So 27,250 is the balance on 1/1/2020. The loan amount is 27,250. Just think for a while, correct? And I'm supposed to make what we call payment on 31st of 12 2020, 10,000. Now, because the loan amount outstanding on 1/1/2020 is 27,250, so how much interest bank will charge? Bank will charge 5% of this amount. Is it clear to you or not? Similarly, in order to know how much amount of interest is included in this installment, I will have to simply find out 5% of 27,250. That is 27,250 into 5%. Into 5%. So first of all, you write the interest amount. Now, if I will compute it, it will be something near about 1,363. 1,363. This is the first step in second year. That, in fact, at the end of the first year, this is your first step, computation of interest. Once you have computed the amount of interest, that means the 10,000 which you are going to make the payment, out of that 1,363 is meant for interest. And if I am going to subtract 1,363 from 10,000, that will tell us how much I am paying for cash price portion. Correct? Are you getting my point or not? So how much I am going to pay for cash price portion, all I have to do is subtract from 10,000. That means from 10,000, I will subtract 1,363. Now, if I am going to subtract 1,363 from 10,000, I think it will be equal to 8,637. So I have broken off this payment into what we call two segments. The one segment is related to interest payment, other segment is related to what we call payment for cash price. That is why it is known as cash price portion. That means this is the portion of the installment which is meant for cash price, because now it will be considered that out of 10,000, I have paid only 8,637 for the cash price or the cost price. So I'm going to subtract 8,637 from this particular amount. This is the third thing which I will have to do. That means at the end of each year, first of all, you are going to compute the interest, then subtract this interest from 10,000 to know your cash price portion. And whatever your cash price portion is there, you simply subtract it from what we call your cash price to know now what is the balance of cash price at the end of the first year. If I will subtract it, it will be equal to 18,630. 18,613 will be my balance, and so on. Similarly, on 31st of 12, 2021, that is end of the second year, correct? I will pay the second installment. Again, the sequence will get repeated. I want to know what is the amount of interest included in it. All I have to do is to actually compute 5% of this amount. So that is 18,613 into 5%. Into 5%, I will compute. It will be approximately 931. This is the first thing which I am supposed to do. I will subtract 931 from 10,000. That will be equal to 9069. That will tell me the what we call portion which I have paid against the cash price. So this portion I am going to subtract from here, 9069. Is it clear to you or not? So what is the balance now? I will subtract it. The balance will be equal to 9544. 9544. This is your balance. 9544. Clear? Now this is your balance. 9544. Now try to understand another important aspect. This is your balance 9544. Now you will reach the end of the third and final year, because third installment is your last installment. So third year, you again you are going to write here 10,000. You have written 10,000. Now in the third year, don't compute interest immediately. Suppose if I will compute the interest, okay, let me tell you. Suppose if I compute the interest 9544 into 5%, that will be equal to 477 near about. Just think, don't write at this moment, correct? Because I will have to rub it off. Suppose in the final year, if I am going to repeat these steps, computation of interest first, and suppose if I subtract 477 from 10,000, what will happen? That will be equal to 9523. I will have to write here 9523. And this I will have to subtract from here 9523. But the problem is that, as you can see, it will not get closed, because it is 9544 and this figure is 9523. Still there will be balance. Because we are in the final year, we want that no balance should be there at the end of the final year. So that is why in the final year, what you will have to do, just pay attention. In the final year, it is natural that I do not want any balance. I do not want any balance. If I do not want any balance, what figure should I subtract 9544? That means in the final year, first of all, I will write this figure first. And we know this figure means cash prize portion, 9544. Then you put it simply over here. Now, if I am going to ask you, could you tell me what is the interest? What is the interest? Your installment is 10,000. Out of 10,000, 9,544 is being considered as payment for cash price portion. So the difference of 10,000 and 9,544, that is equal to 456. This 456 will be considered as your interest. Is it clear to you? That means in the final year, we do not want to actually have any sort of balance. So that is the reason in the final year, it is better, first of all, write the same amount over here, put this amount over here, and then compute this amount. How you computed this amount? You simply take the difference of 10,000 and 9,544, that is 456. This is how you are supposed to do what we call computation of interest. And why we do the computation of interest? In fact, the topic is computation of interest, but the basic theme is that we want to break the installment into two separate parts because we want to know how much interest we are paying, correct? And how much of the installment we are paying for against the what we call cash price. That is the basic reason. Now, we will learn the ledger accounting in the books of ledgers, how ledgers are prepared, correct? Ledgers. In the books of, in the books of, in the books of purchaser. We will see later on that as far as purchaser is concerned, correct? Purchaser, that is hire purchaser. Purchaser will prepare two types of account. We will see later on. One, he will prepare hire vendor account, and secondly, he will prepare the asset account. First, he will prepare hire vendor account. Here I am going to write hire vendor account. Correct? Hire vendor account. Purchaser in his books will prepare hire vendor account and asset account. How he is going to actually prepare this particular account? The point important is that, correct? So for the same, you need to know a bit of what we call accounting entries, which I will make you understand later on. This is just for the sake of the fact that I just want to give you an overview of this particular chapter. First of all, the day on which hire purchaser is going to buy the asset, what entry he is going to write? His entry is going to write motor vehicle account debit. You need not require to write entry at this moment. Motor vehicle account debit to hire vendor account. Why this entry and what is the meaning of this particular entry? Because I have bought an asset, that is motor vehicle account, correct? And I am supposed to pay you this much of amount, correct? That is why this particular entry we are going to write. Because in the entry I have written motor vehicle to hire vendor, that means hire vendor account is getting credited. So I will go over to the credit side of the hire vendor account. I will mention the date, that is 1/1/2020, the day on which we bought the asset. So I am going to write here by asset account or simply by motor vehicle account. Motor vehicle account. This is MV, motor vehicle account. Now the next question is, at what price it should be recorded? It should be recorded at cost price logically, because accounting standard AS10 which deals with fixed asset or property, plant, and equipment, simply states that all the assets must be recorded at cost price. Now, what is the cost price? That is 37,000. What was the cost price? 37,250. You are going to pass this entry with the cost price. Now, some of you may actually think, sir, this is the cash price. But I told you in the beginning, this is the cash price for the seller. But this is the cost price for the purchaser. So that is the reason motor vehicle will be recorded at 37,250. Then, in the beginning means on the first day, on the same date, we are going to make the payment to the hire vendor. My entry will be hire vendor account debit to bank account. Correct? I'm simply giving you a rough idea at this moment regarding entry. We will talk about entries in detail later on. Don't worry. So as per this entry, hire vendor account will get debited. So I'm going to write on 1/1/2020. I will write here to bank. It means down payment, DP. How much payment you made? You made 10,000 worth of payment. So in the beginning, you are going to pass these two entries. First for purchasing the asset and second to make the payment to the hire vendor with respect to down payment. Now, when we will reach the end of the first year, at the end of the first year, what will be my entry? At the end of the first year, first of all, the purchaser will pass an entry, an interest account debit to hire vendor account. Why this entry? Because at the end of the first year, when we will reach, it means interest has become due. If interest has become due, that means my liability, purchaser's liability towards hire purchaser will increase. If the liability will increase, the hire, that means I'm supposed to pay more amount to hire vendor. So that is why hire vendor account will be credited. So as per this entry, hire vendor is getting credit. So that is the reason I am going to write towards the credit side, 31/12/2020, I am going to write interest. And we have computed the amount of interest. That is the reason why we computed the interest. If you remember, we computed interest, that is 1,363. At the end of the first year, the interest amount is 1,363. So you are going to write here 1,363. 1,363. Correct? Now, again, you are going to make the payment at the end of the first year. At the end of the first year, your first entry is interest account debit to hire vendor. Then your second entry will be hire vendor account debit to bank account. That means at the end of the first year, you are going to make the first installment. So at the end of the first year, I will pay the first installment. Again, I am going to write hire vendor account debit to bank account. And this is my first installment. Correct? What is the amount of first installment? 10,000. Now try to understand. When I am paying 10,000 rupees in the first installment, this is the amount of the first installment. Try to understand this point. When I am paying 10,000 rupees of the first installment, that means I have paid interest of 1,363 and I have paid 8,637. Are you getting my point or not? So that is how the first installment is paid. Now that means the first year work is over. Now all I have to do is to just balance it. Now I will balance the same. I will, sorry, balance the same now. If I will balance the same, what will be my balance carried down? Balance carried down. At the end of the first year, balance will be 18,630. In fact, you need not require to do any computation. You can have a look from here itself also. You can see at the end of the first year, balance is 18,600. Otherwise, you can simply balance it as we normally do. Now, we will move into the next year. The next year will start from 1/1/2021. First of all, I will write the balance brought down. The balance brought down, as we saw, is 18,613. 18,613. Now we have reached the second year. Correct? The first year task is already over. When I will reach the second year, again I will pass this entry. First I will make the interest due and then I will make the payment. Are you getting my point or not? That means these two sets of entry will continue now. So I will reach the end of the first year, sorry, reach the end of the second year, 31/12/2021. I will pass the entry for interest due, interest account debit to hire vendor. And we have already computed the amount of interest. We have already seen the interest in the second year was 931, isn't it or not? Then I will make the payment on 31st of 12, 2021. I will write here to bank. This is my second installment. Second installment, 10,000 rupees. So that means if I'm paying 10,000 rupees, it includes payment for interest and payment for cash price portion. Now again, I am going to write here balance carried down. Now what is the balance after what we call second installment? What is the balance amount? Correct, we have paid 18,600. So the balance amount is 9,544. 9,544. Is it clear to you? Now we will reach the final year. In the final year, I am going to write here 1-1-2022. I am going to write here balance brought down. The balance brought down happens to be 9,544. In the final year also, I will pass two entry, first for interest due and then for payment. So when I will make the interest due, the entry will be 31st of 12, 2022. Entry will be by interest. In the computation which we did, the last year interest was computed as 456. Is it clear to you? And now we will make the final payment on 31st of 12, 2022. The final payment will be to bank and the final payment, that is 10,000. Obviously, this account will get closed after this particular payment. Is it clear to you or not? So this is how you are going to prepare hire vendor account in the books of purchaser. In the books of purchaser, not only hire vendor account is prepared, but also we will see that an asset account is also prepared. Asset account, that is motor vehicle account in this particular case, which is very simple. Just for the sake of understanding, I am telling you motor vehicle account. Motor vehicle account. Correct? We have seen that when we wrote here, correct? Here we wrote in the beginning on 1-1-2020 by motor vehicle. So quite obviously towards the debit side of motor vehicle, I am going to write 1-1-2020 to hire vendor and the price will be 37,250. 37,250. I am the purchaser. In substance, I am also the real owner. In substance, I am talking about. In substance, I am the owner, even though I may not be the real owner. Now, I will reach the end of the first year and charge depreciation, 31st of 12, 2020. In this question, it was given that depreciation rate is 10%. So I am going to charge depreciation at the rate of 10% of this particular value, that is 3725, and so on. Then I will simply balance it. Balance carried down and your balance will be equal to 33,525. That means at the end of the first year, the purchaser will reflect the motor vehicle in the balance sheet at this particular amount. Similarly, 1-1-2021, next year will start. I will simply write balance brought down and the balance brought down happens to be 33,525, isn't it or not? Yes, sir. We will reach the end of the year, 31st of 12, 2021. Again, I am going to charge depreciation. Now, in the question, it was given that depreciation is on reducing balance system, that is on written down value system. So now I will charge 10% of this amount. Now, approximately, that will be equal to 3352. Otherwise, I will have to write 3352.5. So I appropriated it. Then again, I will simply write balance carried down, that is 30,173. This is a mere formality, to be very honest with you, as far as preparation of asset account is concerned. Then again, 1-1-2022, again I am going to write balance brought down. The balance brought down happens to be 30,173. Then at the end of the year, 31st of 12, 2023, 22, sorry, I will write by depreciation. I will compute 10% of this figure, that is equal to 3017. Now the balance carried down is equal to 27,156. So purchaser will prepare the accounts in this manner. Correct? How the accounting is done in the books of purchaser? We took a little bit of what we call idea about it. Of course, we are going to take at great length what we call accounting in the books of purchaser, and of course accounting in the books of vendor. We haven't talked in this particular question how we are going to prepare accounts in the books of the vendor. I will let you know in the next session. So I think in this particular session that is more than sufficient, and you must have enjoyed this particular session. By now you are feeling a little bit of confidence now, correct, what we have to do under hire purchase system. So not a tough chapter once the initialities are overcome, correct? So if you are quite okay with the initial basics and conceptuality of this particular chapter, later on I'm very sure that you are not going to confront or face any sort of problem in comprehending this particular chapter, correct? So on such count, we finish up today's this particular session. Shall meet you again later on, correct, with something new.